Everybody ready?
Ready?
Yeah.
All right, listen.
It's your weekend show.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
With Bob Biermann.
It's great.
And welcome to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. I'm so glad you're taking some time to spend it with me. I'm so excited that this program has now been on the air, getting close to 2 years now. And the audience grows around the world. This past weekend, the program seemed to get more listeners than we've had in quite a while. So that really made me feel well. There are times that when you do a program like this, you wonder if anybody is really taking the time to listen. Is it worth the effort and the time you put into doing a program like this? And when the numbers come in, it gives you a sense of reward for the effort. And I'm humbled that you do take time each and every week to listen. A couple of personal things to share. This weekend is kind of special for me. My wife keeps reminding me that this weekend, October 16th, it's my birthday. I'm 62 this year. And it's a milestone. I wondered many, many years ago which direction my life would take. I remember when I was a young child, I had an aspiration to do several things like all young boys do growing up. And I guess when I was like in the sixth grade, I thought about being an airline pilot. I thought about joining the Navy or flying an airplane. All the things that young men go through. Part of me had this love of music and even the church that I was involved in. And I wrestled around the time I was 12 and 13 with maybe heading in that direction for life. But I also loved radio and communications as a youngster, listening to radio stations where I lived in just outside of New York City. And I always wondered what it would be like to maybe someday be a radio announcer. And I got to that point by the time I was 16. And I've loved the radio business ever since. It's been a part of who I am for really the majority of my life. And as I look back now, I could have done other things for a living and maybe made more money, but you know something? I feel that what I did career-wise was rewarding, and I hope that I either entertained, informed, or helped people along the way. And that's what your weekend show is all about. It's a program about life. We share from life's rich experiences. We share our triumphs and our tragedies and the things that go well, the things that go wrong, and try to find sense and understanding about the life that we live each and every day. This program is heard on a number of radio stations. It's also heard online. And this weekend, as I start the program, I want to take just a moment, to ask of you a favor. This program is aired on a number of radio stations, shortwave in particular, to reach an international audience. And I would like to find out which stations are the ones that are being listened to each and every week. I know the program is now heard on the Voice of Hope. It's on two high-power transmitters broadcasting from Africa in the country of Zambia. And I know that we're getting listeners in Europe, all over the continent of Africa and other locations from that facility. And that facility in particular means a lot to me. And what's happening with the Voice of Hope internationally and even domestically in the United States excites me. And I'm privileged. I feel honored to be permitted to have this program on that radio station. The program is also heard on a local FM radio station in the region that I live in, South Florida, on the East Coast, WCNO, FM 89.9. It's a 100,000-watt FM that, it covers Palm Beach, West Palm Beach, all the way up through Melbourne, Florida, up the Space Coast and the Treasure Coast, and has the potential reach in the millions. And I would like to know if you're listening to me today on WCNO. The station is also heard on WRMI, which is based out of Okeechobee, Florida. It's an international station. We are on several frequencies that cover into North America, into Europe, into Asia, and the Middle East. And so I'd like to know if you're listening, perhaps, to this program on WRMI. And recently we added a radio station out of Pennsylvania, WINB, also a shortwave station, whose reach is from Pennsylvania back toward the western and southwestern part of the United States. Each week I produce the program and make sure this program is available to these stations. But right now I would really like to know how you're listening to your weekend show. It would mean more to me today than you'll ever know as we produce this program and try to decide what is the most effective use of time and the most effective use of this hour that we spend together, the things we share. What would you like to hear more of is one of the questions that I have. But it's very important for me to know where you're listening. Now, I know we're also heard on a number of online venues. The website is one, yourweekendshow.com. That's yourweekendshow.com. It's also heard on Spreaker and SoundCloud. And if you're listening there, let me know as well. It means a lot to me to know where you're listening and where the effort should be as we move forward week in and week out with this radio program. As I approach this milestone in my life, I am more convinced day by day that really using the radio, using the broadcast medium, and even using the internet are ways to proclaim a very important message. I came to conclude in the last several weeks, and I've been really wrestling with this at night. Maybe you have too. We look at this world around us, and it becomes so disappointing as we try to make sense out of what's going on in the world around us today. And we get upset, we get angry, raise our blood pressure over issues and things we see that are wrong, and we want to fight back. But the Lord laid something on my heart in these past 2 weeks that has become very profound. And I'm going to be talking about that in just a little bit on the program. Maybe we're fighting the wrong battle in this war. We spend more time arguing and trying to win an argument and not really change hearts and lives for the better. And I'm beginning to realize that simply arguing and being a culture warrior is not the solution to the world's problems. We can complain about this, that, or the other, what this person did, what this person said in politics, no matter what part of the world you live in. But until the human condition and the human heart is changed, the governments we have and the people that lead us are nothing more than a reflection of the world around us. Maybe instead of trying to fight the symptom, it's time we look for a cure for the disease. And like I say, we'll talk about that in just a few minutes. But as I said, it's important to me right now, and it would mean the world to me if you would take the time and let us know that you are listening to this radio program. And it's vital that I know this week where and how you are listening, so I can better assess what the program needs to do, where it needs to be, and what needs to be the content of this program in the days, weeks, and months ahead. Would you take the time this week and let me know? If you have online access, let me give you a couple of ways you can contact the program. The first, always, is our website, which is yourweekendshow.com. That's yourweekendshow.com. And there's a contact button on the homepage, and you can send me an email directly and let me know that you're listening. Maybe some ideas about the program. And also where you're listening. I'm not asking for anything more than that. I'm not asking for any kind of contributions or support. That's not what this program is about. This program is about sharing. And I try to take a little time each week to produce this radio program and make sure that it gets out each and every week. And it would mean a lot to me if you would just take that one moment to let me know that you are listening. Are you listening on International Shortwave? If so, which station? WRMI out of Okeechobee? Are you listening to WINB out of Red Lion, Pennsylvania? Are you listening to the Voice of Hope in Africa? Please let me know from the website, yourweekendshow.com. That's yourweekendshow.com. Maybe you're listening to Rackman Christian Radio, which is online, and I appreciate the fact they've been carrying this program literally from the very beginning of this program over a year and a half ago. And so I'm excited that we do have this opportunity each and every week. Maybe you're listening on WCNO, broadcasting from Palm City, Florida. And if so, it would be extremely important for me to know that you're listening on that facility. Speaking of WCNO, I am supposed to be helping them with their annual prayer and praise, where they do their annual fundraising, or this time of the year fundraising in October. And I'm supposed to be on the air with them during the course of this coming week. And so we are praying about that and trying to see the Lord's direction in what we should be doing with WCNO. So once again, your prayers are also coveted. And if you're a Facebook user, of course, we're there too. Go to your Facebook page, and in the search, just look for Your Weekend Show. Make it one word, Your Weekend Show, and it'll take you right to us. And you can also, from there, you'll find a connection even on our website, yourweekendshow.com, how to get to my personal Facebook page, if you'd like to contact me there too and maybe become a friend. And if you go to the Facebook page for the radio show, do what a number of other people did this past weekend. Like it. I would appreciate that. That gives me an idea of how the program is growing and where you're listening and if we're having an impact. If you don't have internet access, the other thing you can do is simply send a letter or contact by phone the radio station to which you're hearing the program today. And that will get to me as well. So as we begin this program today, it is important that I hear from you this week. Just to let me know, no more, no less. I'm not asking for anything. I don't need you on a mailing list. I'm not going to, you know, send you materials and inundate your inbox with anything or request. We just do this program because, well, we've been blessed to have the opportunity. And I just want to make sure that the place that we're broadcasting from is the place we should be broadcasting from. And also the content of the program. If there's maybe a topic you'd like to see addressed, this would be your opportunity to feed back and share with me your thoughts about your weekend show. I stand amazed each week that I have this incredible opportunity for my small voice to be heard in so many diverse places. I think back over this past year, some of the email that I have received from the program around the United States, across Europe, Germany, the United Kingdom, even the Middle East. We know for a fact that people have listened to this radio program in the Holy Land, in Israel. We know they've listened in Egypt and Pakistan and even Iran. We know the show has been heard in Canada. It's been heard in Australia, in Germany, in France, in Italy, London, England, Scotland, the Philippines, India, Sri Lanka, just to name some that are coming to mind where I've read letters. And it means the world to me that you are listening somewhere in this world of ours. Would you do that favor for me this week and take the time to share with me your thoughts about your weekend show? Also want you to pray for one of our outlets, and that is the Voice of Hope. The Lord has really given them an incredible opportunity, and I want you to pray for them as they are moving forward with some major projects. And I hope to be able to share more about what they're doing from my website in the next week or two to see what they're doing. And I plan on helping them out any way that I can from an engineering standpoint or anything else that they need, because I believe they're doing the work of the Great Commission. It's easy for a lot of places to build a domestic ministry in the United States and count upon those that support that ministry for them to function day in and day out. But Voice of Hope is taking this great message to the world, to the people that don't often have internet access and money to spare. But in God's economy, they are equally as important. And just because we live in a country of abundance in the United States, where I live, doesn't mean we have less of an obligation to those around us. When Jesus gave that great commission before he left this earth, he said, "Go ye therefore into all the world." He didn't say into your neighborhood, into your country, into your hometown. The message was to take the message into all the world and teach all nations, not some nations, not your nation, not a nation you like, all nations. And as I keep doing this program, day in and day out, week in and week out, I become more aware inside of me of that awesome responsibility to share this message that's on my heart, not just with the people in my community or the church in which I attend or churches that I've known and have been a part of over the years, in the states that I've lived in the United States, or the entire country, or the entire continent of North America. No, this message needs to be taken into South America, across the dark parts of Europe that are still in kind of a bondage. The Middle East in particular, Iran and Iraq, yeah. There is so much the gospel can do to change the condition of this world. And so that's what I want to spend the rest of my life doing. I've enjoyed the broadcast industry, and I will hopefully and prayerfully continue to do so. But I want to spend, beginning at the end of this year, literally 100% of the time that God gives me on this earth. I'll be 62, Sunday, October the 16th. And my wife and I are making plans right now to allow that possibility to really use these last productive years of my life for the cause of the gospel. As I started the program today, I was telling you about what the Lord has been laying on my heart and my mind about this day and age that we live. There are people you'll find on radio and television and pulpits all across the United States and even the world that talk about the end times. And yes, the end times are important. There's no doubt in my mind that every day that slips by, we come one day closer to the end of the world as we know it. No doubt in my mind. And this program, part of what we try to do is to have you ready for being ready. But for many Christians, we spend so much of our time fighting the wrong battle. We can argue about the culture, we can argue about politics until the cows come home. And what have we accomplished? Have we really changed anybody's mind fighting a logical battle? The Bible says there are those that have been given over to a reprobate mind. And the problem is, when you try to argue logic, they can't comprehend the logic, and you get into an argument where nobody's mind has changed, and all you've succeeded in doing is create anger and angst. And it became clear, the battle is not mine. My job is to share the good news. And so I want you to get your hearts and minds into in focus here for a moment. And when we come back in just a couple of moments from right now, I want to share the sermon that I preached from Amazing Grace Anglican Church this past Sunday, October the 9th, in Jensen Beach, Florida. And I hope that this sermon will have an impact on you. But as we get ready to receive and hear God's word, I want you to focus on this song as we prepare our hearts and our minds to receive what God has for his people and his church. This is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Biermann.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
The words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
I want to share, you may be seated, of course, I want to share a couple of random thoughts before I get into today's message. Some of it comes from our epistles, some from the gospel, and some from some memories. And I'm thinking that it was 12 years ago I had gone through Hurricane Charlie, where I lived on the other coast of Florida. And while there were some areas just south of us that had some substantial damage, for the most part, most people were very much spared extensive damage, except in the immediate Punta Gorda area. I always got a kick that the people from the Weather Channel, in all their wisdom and all their knowledge, trying to track this hurricane and knowing where it was going to go, they wanted to be staged in a safe place south of Tampa, and they chose a hotel in Punta Gorda, which ended up being the bullseye for Hurricane Charlie. Which shows how much we really knew then about hurricanes, about as much as we know today about hurricanes. My dear wife was inundated with messages from her sister in Oregon that thought for sure that we were going to be under 20 feet of water and 200-mile-an-hour winds and be wiped off the face of the earth.
We live by the turnpike. We are not on the shore. And they're still having a hard time believing the power never went off. The internet stayed on. You know, we slept all night. They don't get it. But they watch the Weather Channel. And they watch the news. And I worked in the news for a number of years in my career. And I know the mandate is the bigger the headline, the bigger the audience, the bigger the audience, the more we can charge. That's what it boiled down to. I didn't much like news back in those days. But I was thinking this morning as I'm driving here today that my late wife was a good Baptist gal, and she always missed some of the good Baptist hymns because we had in our church even a worse hymnal than you have here. We had the 1940 hymnal, which had 70% obscure songs that nobody sings. Period. So she always missed that. And I happened to think, and I always kept a hymnal just like this one. You have one here at the church in my office. And I thought what we had just learned comes from a great old Baptist hymn that goes like this. In the dark of the midnight have I oft hid my face, while the storm howls above me and there is no hiding place. Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. And there are two more verses I want to quickly go through. Many times Satan whispered, there is no need to try, for there is no end of sorrow and there is no hope in the by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow I'll rise where the storm never darkens the skies. And then the third verse. When the long night has ended, and I thought about that after this storm because it came during the night, and the storms come no more, let me stand in thy present on that bright and peaceful shore. In that land where the tempest never comes, Lord, may I dwell with thee when the storm passes by. And that's that song just so fit, that hymn, so many years ago when I shared it with that congregation, and it fits today for us. I remember coming to this building the day of the hurricane to make sure things were all right and to get things away from windows and doors that could be damaged. And then I came by yesterday to make sure that everything was all right and get the altar set up and try to work with the PA system a little bit so maybe we can get it where it needs to be working and so we can all hear it better. And I realized that we were very much spared. Now, part of me says there was still a little bit more hype than the reality. Yeah, it could have been a lot worse, but I still don't think it could have been as bad as some were hoping it would be. I say that, hoping it would be. Today in the gospel lesson, there's a story shared, and it always brings to mind an actual incident in my work life in the 1980s. When I worked for a large manufacturer of broadcast equipment, and I had a call one morning from a guy way out in the Midwest, had a radio station, and his transmitter was not functioning correctly, and he was just at his wit's end. How do I get it on the air? I've tried this, I've tried that. And it suddenly hit me. Oh, I think I know what your problem is. Go to this circuit board, go look at this, check this, and it should... If I'm correct, if you make this one change, change this one part out, pretty inexpensive, you'll be fine. About 2 hours later, I got a call back from him, and he said, "Mr. Biermann," I said, "Yeah." He said, "I want you to remember me as the one leper, the one that came back to thank you because you were dead on." He said, "Had it fixed in 10 minutes." And we're back on the air. So always remember me. And there's something to that about the Christian walk in life. And this has been on my heart and mind, not just the last 24 hours, not just the last week, the last couple of months. I have been wrestling inside with looking at this world around me. In the radio show that I do, I frequently talk about the culture and the life that we go through. And I'm getting to a point that I'm beginning to realize what St. Paul truly means when he says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principality and powers. We as the church, I dare say, and I'm now convinced, for the most part, are fighting the wrong battle. We're in the wrong war. We're in the wrong place. The church spends more time talking about Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton than it ever does about Jesus Christ, about 99 times to one. There, my friends, is the problem. When we get caught up in the culture and we don't even talk about the Savior, we're doing exactly what the enemy of our soul wants us to do, be at war and divided. And I've had enough. I have had enough. I look at all the anger that you see on Facebook, and I love the one line I do like that I thought was great. What is a presidential election? 6 months of defriending people on Facebook only to allow Ohio and Florida to choose the president. That's as far as I'm going to go into politics today, because I don't need to. I realize that there are so many people that are so worried about the politics, they forget the principle. If we live to serve Jesus Christ and talk about him, I am tired of talking about men and glorifying and uplifting men or women or anybody. When are we going to lift up the Savior to the world? We are so busy fighting the wrong battle. We have the world fighting against us, and they will never listen. We are not giving the good news. We're giving war news. This has got to stop. The church in America today has been reduced to a couple of things. And we can look at the book of Revelation to see some of it, as we discussed before. Either the church has to compromise its theology, it's got to compromise its steadfastness in God's word to be acceptable, on one hand, to the world, or in trying to keep the message pure, they have to move into a more entertainment mode. And I have nothing against praise music. Believe me, I love it and I think we should use it. But we get more into the light show and the smoke machines than we do into the Spirit of God. There's a satire website, and sometimes people will see a story there and they'll think it's real, and I'm going, oh, please. It's called the Babylon Bee. Have anybody ever heard of that one? The Babylon Bee. It is actually one of the funniest websites you could ever go to. It is absolute satire at its best. And it's written and put together by a graduate of Liberty University. And you talk about funny stuff, but it's satire on the church. And unfortunately, there's so much truth in it. Satire is only funny when there's truth in it. And this is why this one's extremely funny, because it's extremely truthful. And I'm not going to give away the headlines, but Babylon Bee, B-E-E, just like, you know, the old style newspapers. And this thing, some people will share a story or two from Facebook, you know, from there, and they are great. They are outstanding. One was, you know, the Spirit of God left our church when the smoke machine quit. Was one, you know, and how we're never going to let that happen again. We're going to get extra machines and have them on the ready with generators. Can't have that happen again. I mean, just stories of that nature, because we have gotten ourselves, I think, wrapped up in so many of the wrong things. In today's epistle lesson, we started, you know, is in Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 3. And this is a section of scripture where St. Paul is writing to Timothy. And it starts out in the early part with the well-known, we've all heard this, I hope, that know this, that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heedy, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For this sort they have creep into houses, led captive silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lust. And the most important part, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. And that's why I am more and more convinced that in many areas of my life, I have been fighting the wrong battle. I have bought into the premise of the culture war, and I can be a culture warrior. Yeah, I did that in my secular life as a talk show host for quite a while. And that's the battleground I was in a secular setting. But as a called and ordained servant of God, I don't need to be fighting in the mud. I have come to conclude, you can wrestle with a pig in the mud all day long, and the pig loves it. Why bother? Why degrade yourself to fight the wrong battle? If you want to change the world, you'll never do it with an argument. If you want to change the world, if you want to see things better, you'll never do it by logic. Because I'm telling you, those that are against the things of God, as it says in the book of Romans, have been given over to a reprobate mind to begin with, and they couldn't comprehend logic. They won't hear it. They can't see it. Even St. Paul is saying, in these times, they're ever learning, they're hearing, but because their heart is not changed, because Jesus Christ is not inside of them, because the power of the Holy Spirit has not convicted them of their sin, they can hear, you can argue all day long, and nothing changes. How do you argue with somebody that cannot discern the truth? They're never going to hear it. I have looked at Scripture, and I've thought about this all through last night. I would wake up, and I'm trying to think, where does Jesus say, go into the marketplace and defend a candidate? He doesn't. Where does Jesus say, go to a meeting and get into a logical argument? He doesn't. It dawned on me, he says, go ye therefore into all the world, preaching the good news of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you something. It hit me. I know I've realized this for years, but it hit me so strongly this morning that until the heart has been changed by the power of the Holy Spirit and the acceptance of Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are under a reprobate mind and nothing will change. We are fighting the symptom, not the disease. We can fight a symptom and argue and get mad at each other. It's like trying to argue with somebody about life issues. They are so determined, they don't recognize what the Lord laid on my heart this past week. In doing the radio show, I'm preparing on, I guess it was Tuesday. I had to do the show a day early because I didn't know what the weather was going to be. And I'm sitting in the studio at this last minute trying to come up with a radio show. And I'm talking about the incident that occurred where I used to work at in Anderson County up in Townville, South Carolina. Those were my people you saw on television. That was my fellow workers you saw. And had I still been there, I would have been out in that situation for several days. Because I also worked not only in information, but after the fact as a chaplain And I know that there were some guys that took that 1 6-year-old and revived him twice. It did ultimately pass away. And I know that it really has just hurt them deeply inside. They tried so hard. And there, this young, happy child is now gone. How do you make sense of a world like this? Dawned on me when I was in high school, we used to bring our hunting rifles to school and put them in our lockers. Today, you chew a Pop-Tart to look like a gun and they'll expel you. This is where we have gone. It's ludicrous. It's madness. And we are trying to fight that logically. When you have the reprobate mind, it cannot comprehend the arguments of politics or logic. Their minds are like concrete, thoroughly mixed up and too well set. This is what we are fighting. And to try to fight the battles of our faith in a secular world with secular tools and secular arguments is a fool's errand. St. Paul called preaching the foolishness of preaching because it makes no sense to the reprobate mind. It makes no sense to human logic. It makes no sense to our thought process. But it makes sense to the Holy Spirit because through those words and through the Word of God given to us over the centuries, the Word of God is like a double-edged sword. It cuts to the quick, separates the bone from the marrow. Our arguments and logic are like using rubber knives to cut something. It's not going to happen. You need the power of the Holy Spirit. Like I say, I spent years as a talk show host fighting the arguments, debating those that just love to debate. I used to have on one of the radio stations that I was on, I had our happy neighborhood atheist that had to call at least twice a week and engage in a long conversation. And no matter what logical argument you tried to give, his mind was never going to be changed, ever. I have those that would explain to me that it's a woman's body and her right to choose this and that and the other, and no matter how you explain what partial birth abortion was, it didn't make any difference. It's still not alive. It's a reprobate mind. They can't see. St. Paul in the first chapter of Romans talks about as we worship the creation rather than the creator, we're given over this reprobate mind. We start doing goofy and silly things and think they're normal. And we think the world's nuts. Having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. How many church bodies can I think of today that once stood for something and now stand for whatever is expedient, convenient, and happy? I can think of a lot. And that's a sad commentary. How many churches have compromised to keep people in the pews and money in the offering plate and to keep the establishment going another year, maybe another decade? And even with all the compromise they have made, they are still slowly eroding away. Others have tried to use entertainment. They fill fast, but they dissipate quickly when something newer or better comes down the road. Always seeking, you know, I'm going to add one more thing that I wasn't planning to add to this message, but I'm going to quickly do it. It may not so much to apply to this congregation, but in my years as I was growing in the Lord, post high school and in college, I attended a lot of different churches outside of my Missouri Synod Lutheran Church. I visited Assembly of God churches. I visited, you name it, I've been there in any kind of a church. I remember going to a place called Love Inn, which was up in upstate New York. It was run by a former disc jockey turned Christian, and it was well known. The guy's originally from Scotland. Scott Ross was his name, and he was a great disc jockey in New York City. And then he was producing his Scott Ross show for CBN Radio at the time out of this place in upstate New York. And I have been there. And I enjoyed looking for all these new spiritual highs. And there was always a letdown. Always a letdown. Oh, I was even going to Messianic churches in New York City, in Long Island, in 1986 while working, before my voice kind of got shot a little bit, while working at Toccoa Falls College in broadcasting. I was asked to be the minister of music at a big Baptist church to lead their singing and their choir. I've been through the gambit of Christianity. I have had the privilege of saying Mass in a Roman Catholic church with a very unusual set of circumstances, the largest one in Sarasota, after I had met their bishop as a hospice chaplain, saying, I've got a lot of your people that come to me when they see the collar. And he said, hey, your orders are a little irregular, but they're thoroughly valid. And he wanted me to become good friends with a number of his people that I had to deal with. And one Wednesday, I was at the church, and I needed to borrow some altar wine and a host because my altar guild failed to give me due warning to order this stuff. And I realized I'm out. And I was always told, as I went up there, because they use the same exact type host that I did at this one church, and I knew this, the head guy. We're sitting there talking. He goes, oh, come on with me. He said, what's going on? I said, we got a quick noon mass coming up. You want to join me up there? We got a vestment will fit you. So I'm sitting up there, and he goes, you want to say it? It's pretty easy to read. I said, yeah. In a church that big, they thought I'm one of the other 40 or 50 priests that are wandering through. You know, so I'm just reading the new Roman version of the Mass and just following the instructions. It was fun. I've had the experiences of being in so many places and to do so many things, and it always comes back to God's Word and the purity of worship. We, at times in the modern church, go to a church to get something to fulfill us. And we forget that worship really comes from the word workship. It's what we're giving unto Him. And as long as we're going to a place to get something rather than give something, we never receive anything of any long-term benefit except the thrill of the moment. There's another Baptist hymn I'm going to close with that really sums up where I live at in my mind today and where I know my ministry is going to propel me from this day forward in everything that I do. There's a world out there that needs to hear the gospel message, and it's not getting there as it should. We take pride into being in this location, that location, to have our ministry here and our mega cathedrals, whatever, here, there, and other way, but we're missing the point. To spread the news to every one of God's creatures. There are those people out there that are ready to hear and receive the message that's not there. And we live in a nation of the reprobate mind that doesn't want to hear it anymore. We've heard it. We're done. The Lord will bring me those in this nation that I can reach because they're ready by the conviction of the power of the Holy Spirit. Because not one thing I can say or argue any longer does any good. And the heartbreaking part of that is there are people that I know and love that even one person from my former church on the other coast that is so now given into being pro-abortion, pro-this, pro-everything. And I'm going, where did this come from? Where did this come from? And it dawned on me it was always there. It's just now it's free to be expressed because the market is more open to the absurd. The things we used to keep in the closets, and then we kept in silence, and we kept in dark places. You know, there was a time, and I read this, that certain behaviors hid in the back alleys. Now it parades down Main Street. Yeah. This is the world, and you're not going to fight it with logic anymore. My job is just to preach the gospel, the foolishness of preaching, Him crucified, Him resurrected, Him coming again. It may sound foolish. It may sound, but how's that going to change anybody? It certainly did on the day of Pentecost. 3,000 added like that to the church. Like I say, we spend all of our time arguing the wrong thing, and people then will say, and so that's why you believe in that silly faith. You're arguing the wrong thing. No, my job is to live for the gospel. Lori and I could probably spend the next hour sharing with you the things that God has put on our hearts and our minds, and the things that, you know, that I'm wrestling with. And I realize from Ephesians, he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come into unity of faith and the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Nowhere does St. Paul say, go to the marketplace and support this political idea and fight for it in the name of God. No, he just says, preach the gospel. The gospel will change the life. You know, when the heart is changed, for real, then the blinders and the scales come off the eyes, and you see yourself for who you are for the first time. A sinner in need of God's grace. And you watch as God takes things that are negative out of your life and fills it with his grace and his spirit. Then he finds this area and you grow and he gives you knowledge. The retrobate mind is healed, literally healed. There's a term I've used in the past and it makes more sense now than ever. I believe that we as a nation, the majority of the people in this country, are suffering what I call spiritual syphilis of the brain. Diseases like that generally come from bad behavior, doing the things you know you shouldn't do. And we have corrupted ourselves in our body, spirit, soul, and mind. How do you fight the things of Satan with logic? He can fight back with even more logic. And sound good. Be persuasive. No. I'm done being a cultural warrior. I have only one job, like St. Paul, to preach him crucified, risen, and coming again. If I don't do that, the churches will never grow. The arguments just get more verbose, more full of angst and anger, and the greater the divide, because we're fighting the wrong battle. Fighting the wrong battle. All of our resources, all of our time and effort are in the wrong place. Lord Jesus, I come to you today asking your forgiveness for me, for I have failed you in fighting the wrong battle. Lord, your word made it clear, the work you had laid out. The word made it clear what I, as a called and ordained servant, should do. Lord, I pray your forgiveness on me, and I pray that you'll lead and guide me by your Holy Spirit to that place you would have me to be, to preach the message you would have me to preach, to raise up a church that will be marked pure and without blemish before you. Lord, empower me by your Holy Spirit to do that. And Lord, now I pray for this congregation. Lord, my heart tells me it struggles week in and week out. And Lord, what is the calling for this place? Put this on our hearts and our minds. Oh, Father, I thank you that we come united to your table to receive of you. Now empower us with your Holy Spirit to do the work you've called us to do. For this we ask in Jesus' name, and all the people of the Lord said, amen and amen.
You are here, moving in our come east, I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here moving in a mist. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Hey, we make a miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. We make a miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Believe another week has come and gone as it always seems to do. Once again, would you take time to let me know you're listening to Your Weekend Show? Go to our website, yourweekendshow.com. That's yourweekendshow.com. Or find us on Facebook, Your Weekend Show, all one word, Your Weekend Show. Or even contact the radio station to which you listen to. Until next week at this same time, this is Bob Biermann wishing God's greatest blessings upon you.